Yeah, we're fine.
All right, well, good evening, everyone. It's 6 o'clock and we're going to call this meeting to order. Thanks so much for attending tonight to everyone who made it to chambers and also anyone who's watching from home. Thank you for being here. I'm Deputy Mayor Todd Attridge. I'll be chairing this public meeting tonight as I'm the chair of the Planning and Development Standing Committee. I'm joined tonight by staff and members of council. We've got Councillor Adam, Councillor Mink, Councillor Clare, Councillor Chris, and Mayor Elena all joining us tonight. We'd like to start with a moment of silent reflection. Do that. And now I'd like to read our Indigenous Land Acknowledgement Statement. We acknowledge that this meeting is being held on the traditional territory of the Mississauga Nations. So we are here tonight for a public meeting that is held in accordance with the provisions of the Planning Act. This meeting is a prescribed requirement under the Act, and it represents only one component of the planning and development process. Please note that no decisions will be made at tonight's meeting. The purpose of the public meeting is for the Planning and Development Committee to inform the public of a proposed zoning bylaw amendment application submitted by Loyalist College for lands owned by 1688405 Ontario Limited, located at 230 Walton Street. The purpose of the zoning bylaw amendment is to rezone the subject lands to Res 1-2 T7. Zone to temporarily permit the land use suite to provide dormitory housing for Loyalist College for 3 years. I'd like to note that the committee members are not here tonight to express their opinions for or against the proposed changes. The time for that will come when the matter is brought forward for consideration at the future meeting of the Committee of the Whole. Before I turn it over to the Assistant Director, you're going to be watching. Yeah, okay. I would like to note that there are sign-in sheets near the entrance. If you wish to be added as an interested party to this item, please be notified. Party to this item and be notified when a notice of decision is issued. Please ensure you fill out the sign-in sheets with your information. On declarations of pecuniary interest, are there any declarations of pecuniary interest from members of council? None were noted in advance. I will now turn it over to the deputy clerk to explain the statutory notice procedure.
Thank you, Chair Attridge. As the deputy clerk, I can advise that the municipality's statutory public notice procedure has been followed and includes advertisement on the municipal website, updated social media content, as well as the proponent has also posted a sign on the property. Notification details are contained within report PD 1823 and within file ZB072023.
Perfect. Thanks very much. And now we'll start with the staff reports. Before we get started, I will send over to Director Davis for a few comments.
Good evening, Chair, Mayor, members of council, and members of the public. I'd like to provide some remarks at the beginning of this meeting on behalf of the Planning and Development Division for the municipality. First, I want to acknowledge that this is an unusual application that comes forward to this public meeting tonight. Unusual in that the municipality of Port Hope and myself, in my authority as the Director of Planning and Development, have initiated this zoning bylaw amendment for the temporary use at 230 Walton Street. I would also, and because of that, it has some different context. So typically when we sit in a public meeting as staff, we make presentations that provide factual information, and I am certain, and I will leave the technical matters, planning matters tonight, to Jacqueline Mann, in her capable hands as my senior planner. She will talk to the technical details of this application. Typically, at a public meeting, staff would not be providing all of the information. However, because we've initiated this process, we will be A, providing all the information, and B, responding to all of your questions tonight. What I would like to address also as secondarily is the municipal interest in this matter and municipally initiated activities in general. The municipality has the authority to and does from time to time initiate zoning bylaw amendments. In fact, spoiler alert, I guess, for the agenda that is forthcoming, on June 20th, we will be bringing forward another, but albeit very different, municipally initiated zoning bylaw amendment that has been ongoing in this community for more than 2 years. And what I speak to is the housekeeping zoning bylaw amendment that was initiated by the municipality in 2021. We hoped to bring forward to council for consideration, discussion, and decision at next week's Committee of Adjustment meeting. That is no different than us initiating this type of zoning bylaw amendment. They are different in size and scope, but it is also within our authority to do such, and we do that stuff from time to time. In this case, however, the municipality has initiated this temporary use zoning bylaw amendment in support of Loyalist College and their desire to establish a new campus in Port Hope, with recognizing the need for accommodations for their students and an appropriate place or a good place at 230 Walton to do such. Last summer, Loyalists announced this intention of establishing a campus in Port Hope and projected a modest first class for the fall of 2023. And as I suspect we will hear tonight from the president of Loyalists, that there has been positive response to the school, its programs, and the new campus in our community. And I think that's a very positive thing for the community, for ourselves, and for economic development in general, which I also oversee in Port Hope. We expect more students than we originally had originally projected. And we recognize also in the capacity of economic development and land use planning in our jurisdiction that we have a very low vacancy rate related to rental properties in our community. And so any opportunity to help bridge the gap, resolve those issues, and certainly lower the burden for vacancies in our community, for the extreme low vacancy rate in our community is an important step. It is in the interest of protecting as best we can the rental stock in our community to support the establishment of this school and Loyalist College in general. We are seeking the opportunity to allow for the establishment of a dormitory or suites, as we call them, at 230 Walton Street to be operated by Loyalist College for a period of up to 3 years. Why 3 years and the temporary nature of it? This helps us allow, will help us to allow and assess Loyalist College's ability to put down permanent stakes in this community. It allows us to support the college as it grows, but it also allows us to consider what more permanent solutions need to be developed and implemented, and to offer accommodations for up to 20 students, as you will hear tonight, for the period of up to 3 years. I would note that at the end of 3 years, the property owner would be required to reapply for another temporary use bylaw if they choose to move forward with continued use of the same way for 3 years, a more permanent bylaw amendment if they wanted it for a longer term period, or whatever other development opportunity they may wish to contemplate for that property. That is within the rights of the property owner and beyond the scope of the municipality. The municipality sees this as a strong opportunity to support Loyalists and their desire to establish in our community, which is why we initiated this process in the first place. And certainly I will leave the technical land use matters up to my senior planner, but I'm certainly happy to answer any questions you may have initially about why we're doing this at this time.
Thanks very much. Are there any questions from council before we begin as to why? No, we're fine. Good. Then we'll start the public meeting. The first item that we're going to be talking about is staff report PD-18-23, RE-ZB07-2023 zoning bylaw amendment application for 230 Walton Street. I'm going to ask Jacqueline Mann to speak to us.
Hi, good evening. Through the chair, the mayor, members of council, and members of the public, thanks for coming out tonight. My name is Jacqueline Mann. I'm a senior planner on contract with the Municipality of Port Hope. I am going to present you with the planning rationale behind this proposal and how it meets our current policy, current bylaws, and what a temporary use bylaw is. Some of the information's already been said, so I can kind of scoot through that. This is site details. So the subject lands are located at 228 230 Walton Street. It's about 0.3 of an acre. It has frontage on Walton Street and on Church Street. The former land use was a police station, and then there was a single detached residential use there. There's one building. There's no changes I'll talk about the proposal after. There's one building that has 355.2 meters squared, and there's a hard surface area that's been used for parking for a long time. It's on existing municipal services, and the adjacent land uses include a range of housing densities and tenancies. So this picture, I think, well, if you're not, the picture in the middle is the subject, the existing building, and you can see there's a driveway access off of Walton Street, so that's facing north on Walton Street. The view west, there's single detached residential buildings. To the east, there are more detached residential buildings. Some of them do have more than one tenant in them or tenancy in them. The view, the upper view is from Church Street looking into the parking area, so you can see the extent of it. And then across the street, there's medium density housing and kind of sprinkled all throughout that part of Walton Street. The proposal that we're looking at tonight is, as Todd has summarized, it's for a term of 3 years. The defined term suite will be added to the permitted uses for 230 Walton through a temporary use bylaw. Suites are defined as a series of rooms of complementary use operated under single tenancy, which includes dormitories. The proposed use would be up to 20 students, 8 students in one bedroom units, and those are the units that are on the right side of the building. And then there's 6 two bedroom units that would have 12 students in them. There will be common spaces such as a recreation room, study, kitchen, and bathrooms, which would all be shared. Loyalist College would manage the building and would have an on-site residential assistant there 24/7, offering support to the residents and the facility. My understanding is Loyalist College would also be in charge of snow removal and all the maintenance of the property during their tenure there. Residents, post-secondary students that would be attending Loyalist College Port Hope campus. Okay, I'm going to skip this slide because Todd's already sort of reviewed all that. This slide is a bit blurry, but it shows the amount of legislation and policy that we need to consider when we're looking at a land use. The Planning Act is the statute, and the PPS, Provincial Policy Statement, is the policy document. The Places to Grow Act, and that's for the Greater Golden Horseshoe. Then we go down to the Northumberland County Official Plan, the Port Hope Official Plan, that is implemented through the land use or the zoning bylaw. And at the bottom, you can see a temporary use bylaw is one tool we have available to council in a situation such as this. I'm just quickly going to go over the different levels. Planning Act is the provincial legislation that sets out the legal framework for land use in Ontario. Within this Planning Act, that's where a temporary use provision is permitted, and it's under Section 39.1. And that says that Council of the Local Municipality may, in a bylaw passed under Section 34, authorize the temporary use of land, building, or structures for any purpose set out therein that is otherwise prohibited by the bylaw. And then there's stipulations under that in that there's a timeline that cannot exceed 3 years. Council may grant further periods of not more than 3 years, and upon the expiry of the time period, they'd have to start over again, and they would have to apply again, which would mean a public consultation process. So just to summarize that slide, the proposed use of suite or dormitory currently is not permitted in the current zoning of 230 Walton Street. But council would have, through Section 39.1, the authority to permit it for 3 years. The PPS, the Provincial Policy Statement, and the Places to Grow Growth Plan for the Greater Golden Horseshoe. Both of those basically encourage development in settlement areas, and Port Hope is considered a settlement area. So growth and also the idea of a complete community is something that's encouraged in the settlement areas. So basically this kind of land use in Port Hope is something that's promoted through provincial policy. The Northumberland County Official Plan Again, it's the next tier down. They have a policy that they want Port Hope to become a complete community, and part of this is to provide a range of educational and training opportunities and a range of housing types for all levels of income and ages. In the Port Hope official plan, suites are not included as a permitted land use. They're actually not permitted as a land use. I don't know why they're in the zoning bylaw in any, they haven't been included in any of the zones, residential zones, which that's what it was designed for. So that's that the official plan outlines that. The official plan also has relevant policy. The temporary use is again permitted through the official plan. I'm not going to read it again. It's the same as before. And economic and financial objectives to provide for a more diversified economic base within the municipality, and social and housing objectives are outlined to encourage the provision of adequate supply of housing accommodation by type and tenure in relation to the needs and demands of both the present and future inhabitants of the municipality. Moving forward. Port Hope zoning bylaw is our implementing bylaw. So the subject lands are zoned Res 1-2. That's a low density residential. Type 2 land uses are permitted there. Currently, as I stated before, suite is not a permitted use in that zone. I provided a few definitions here, and one is sort of the idea of a dwelling unit and the idea of a suite, which are actually very similar if you look at them, in that it's one housekeeping unit that contains sleeping areas and then cooking, eating, and other facilities are shared by the residents. So the proposed temporary use bylaw that we have before us today is to add the term suite to the Res 1-2 zone located at 230 Walton Street. It would be exception number T7, temporary 7, and it would be a suite for 20 students of Loyalist College. We've actually outlined who the people that would be in there are, which usually we don't use. Zoning doesn't zone people, it zones uses, so we're trying to specify and make it as clear as possible. The proposed date enacted is 2023, and this would end in 2026 if it was approved. Some considerations. We've had several comments from the public, and these are considerations that the planning demands you look at as well. Parking is one of the considerations. My understanding is there is existing parking issues in the area already, and questions if this is going to augment those existing parking issues. This, believe it or not, this is the existing parking lot you can see off Church Street. If you measure it out according to the bylaw, which is 5.5 meters by 2.7 meters, very tightly, you can fit 18 cars. It'd be a little hard to do, but you can fit 18 cars in there. And then there's also a driveway off of Walton Street that could fit two, but they would be, whatever you call it. Thank you. What's the word? I'll talk about the... What we've done is when looking at what parking standards we would use for this type of a land use, if we look at the boarding house standards, we've applied those, and that would require 9 parking places. We looked at 10 as a reasonable amount for this kind of use. I also spoke to the director of planning in Belleville, who has to ask what he thought about this providing this parking requirement. And he said in Belleville, they've had no problem with parking in terms of the residents because so many of the students don't have cars. It's in residential areas that they would have more issues with cars, like resident, not an area that has a parking area, if that makes any sense. Another consideration was that this is a 4-minute walk from Loyalist College. So anybody that would be renting here, you're assuming is because they would like to walk, be able to walk to the campus, that they wouldn't have a car. So there is so we have said that 9 parking places would adequately serve this type of land use. And there's more than enough adequate parking to do that, that they wouldn't park on the roads and exacerbate an existing problem that is separate from this application, but still something that needs to be addressed. In terms of traffic, again, Walton is a collector street, and therefore it's designed to handle lots of traffic. So this wouldn't have any impact, especially because we don't think there's going to be that many new cars added. And again, that it's a 4-minute walk to the new Willis campus at 10 Pine Street South. This is more of a summary, not conclusions, but the proposed land use, as we've looked at it in consideration, meets the intent of the applicable provincial policy in that it's in a settlement area. It's adding housing options for, we already have housing issues, but it sort of is a quick fix for at least right now, not adding more housing issues in the current situation. The proposed temporary use bylaw would be a 3-year trial period in essence for this land use of a dormitory style housing for 20 students. I already said that. And again, it supports the development of Loyalist College opening this September. This is the public consultation, which we've already, which has already been addressed, that there was a sign posted on the site and residents were mailed out within 120 meters of the proposed development. I also wanted to, we've had great comments that we will be looking through. Some of them have been addressed through this presentation. We've had also a few comments from interested community members who would are very interested in providing boarding in their houses, and they're wondering how they can get more sort of involved in sort of opening their houses up to students. And so we're putting them in touch with Loyalist College to see if we can sort of build on that sort of community community help, which is wonderful to see. In terms of the next steps, after this meeting, all the comments received would be reviewed and assessed. A planning recommendation report would then be brought to the next committee of the whole meeting. That would either be brought forward to council or not. If it's brought forward to council, there would be a council decision at the following council notice of decision. And then I forgot. And then there's an appeal period of 20 days after if there was a notice of decision. And that's the end. That concludes my presentation. If you have any questions, happy to try to answer them.
Great. Well, thank you very much. That was great. Questions? Yes, Les.
Thank you. I'm sorry I was late. If this didn't go through, what could this building be developed to as an alternate? Could it be a multi-story building?
Yes, through the chair. Yes, it could be developed. It would have to go through planning applications, but it could be high density. They could apply for a high density residential use, medium density residential use.
Thank you. Other questions? No, seeing none. Yeah, thanks very much. We'll move on to 5.2 is a presentation by Loyalist College regarding the proposed land use operation. Thanks.
Well, hello, and thank you, Mr. Chair, Mayor and Council and public. I'm Mark Kirkpatrick. I'm the President and CEO of Loyalist College, and I just want to say thank you for this opportunity to come talk to you about this. I'm going to take a little bit of license here and just to get to the residents part, if that's okay. I think it's probably worthwhile doing a little bit of level setting for everybody who may not have heard some of the story of what we're trying to accomplish here over the next little while. So if you can just bear with me for a couple of minutes, and then we'll get to the specifics of the residence piece. So just basically Loyalist College. So currently we have locations in Bancroft, Belleville, Tyendinaga, Toronto. I'm actually heading there right after this to actually do another convocation there. And of course, we've had a location here in Port Hope on Walton Street for some time. And I call them locations, not campuses, because not all would be deemed a campus. What we plan to do here is actually start to create a campus, which is offering multiple programs, a larger student population, and whatnot. Overall, for the fall of 2023, our enrollment plan and projections would be just over 4,000 or 7,000 full-time students within Loyalist College in all of our locations. We just convocated over 2,500 in Belleville this week, and I'm doing another 2,000 in Toronto this week. So there's the college is moving and convocating and graduating lots of folks these days. Over 70 programs are offered. We just had another group of programs approved by our board that have gone to the ministry for approval. We are a nationally ranked top 50 applied research college 3 years in a row. So most people don't think colleges do research. We do an awful lot of applied research. I could talk to you an hour about applied research, but that's not why I'm here today. But the most important thing on this slide is actually the last comment, and that is we're a community college. I am very proud to stand up in here and say that we are a community college. And I take the word community very seriously. We are not coming here to put up a storefront. We're not coming here to be a diploma mill. We want to be part of the community. And if you look at every place else we have gone, we work really hard to be part of the community. It's not just about us running a school with students. It's about us also giving back to the community and running programs with the community and creating initiatives that we think help the community grow and get better. Okay, this is who we are and the core of who we are. And I think it's really important that people understand that. And I'm glad you talked to the folks at Belleville, because I'm sure you probably heard the same thing there. I think we all know where the new campus is going. I love this little picture here of St. Mary's School. I don't remember where we found it, but so that's where we're headed, down on Pine Street. That'll be the new campus. We've leased that space over the longer term, and we're off going doing some renovations. So arguably speaking, this is the artistic architectural renditions of what the new campus will look like. I call it a campus in a post-secondary spot, and why we're investing millions of dollars into this space is because we're not building another school. This is going to look like and have the services that a post-secondary school would have. So we'll make sure that it's got all the support systems for our students. We'll make sure that counseling and health supports are there for them. There'll be the library, there'll be labs, there'll be common spaces, there'll be food services, all of which will be provided through this facility. We will get it all fully up to AODA standards. That's why that beautiful place in the middle there with that's going to cost a small fortune, but, because we need to get an elevator shaft in there because the school is on a wonderful hill. And so we've got to deal with a lot of steps, but we'll make sure that this institution, when it is up and fully running, is 100% AODA compliant, washrooms and all going forward. When we start this fall, these are the programs that we're going to be running. I put radiation up there, but radiation, of course, already runs downtown, but we'll continue to run our radiation programs. But we'll be running business, computer systems technician, global project management, and general arts and science workplace stream. It may not appear to most people, but that is actually a very diverse group of programs. It's designed for, as an access route for students who maybe couldn't get into post-secondary, gives them a route into post-secondary. That's what the general arts and science is about. The diploma programs are nice entry programs. They're very consistent, very popular for people to go into. And then of course we have the post-grad programs. So this is now the step of BEOV. So this is, you've already got a diploma and you want to get a post-grad. Different groups of people are attracted to these different programs. It allows us to get a really strong base of students in year one, so that as we move into the future years of the institution, we can actually do appropriate work with you and with the various industries that are around here to make sure that we're aligning programs that the system and the industry needs to grow your economy. These are the right back from when we started this whole process. This was the enrollment forecast that we did over the first 5 years of the campus. You'll see it's relatively modest of 120 students, and we'll probably be around there, give or take, this year. You never know, because you don't know till day 10 when they show up. I'll be honest with you, you just don't know. We'll know for way over, but we won't know how low it may be until day 10. It's some show, some don't. They change their mind quite quickly. But you'll see in year two, it's a modest growth. And then by year three, we're getting to basically where we think our steady state is for the first few years, which is just over 400 students. When we get to 400 students, that's when we will hold. And that's the plan, basically, from a business standpoint, is that's pretty much the count. I have been asked in the past, can I go over 400? Yeah, the facility will do more than 400. We will not go over 400 if the city can't handle 400. We did the same thing in Belleville this year. We have frozen enrollment. Enrollment will not increase in Belleville. From an international, international is frozen, our domestic numbers will still come up, but we're talking maybe 20, 30 students, not big numbers. But we're holding until we actually make sure that, the places that we exist, that call us home, are capable of handling what we're up to. Okay. What I'll probably find is we'll get pushed to actually increase that more so from other people than us, because they'll want programs that do this or do that. And that's what will drive the enrollment more so than us pushing those enrollment numbers. We did some quick demographic information. This is something people are interested in. So this is just people who have applied today to come here to Port Hope across the different programs, whether it's domestic or international. And what you'll see is I talked about the postgrad, which is that global project management program. You'll see the age, the average age is 25. So you'll see they're an older group of people that would come to that because they've already done some post-secondary. They tend to also be international, which is why you see the numbers there. You'll also notice roughly it's probably a little older than the average that you would think of. Colleges tend to have an older group of people than universities. Universities take people right out of high school. Most people don't realize this, but colleges don't. The vast majority of our students are what we call non-direct. So they actually have gone somewhere else first. They've either gone to university and decided to come to college. They've taken time off to work. Or they just maybe gone to another program and want to switch. But they tend to be a little older. So that's why you'll see the average age is probably a little older than you might have thought. And this would be the demographic of the folks that would be in the residence complex that we're talking about. I just wanted to touch on the economic impact. These are the numbers from Belleville. I just wanted to show you these just to give you a sense. And you can extrapolate just by enrollment numbers if you want to get a rough idea of what it might mean to Port Hope. So these were done by MC. They were done right as we were coming out of COVID. So they're actually very low compared to what, if I just run this today, what those numbers would be. This was also done when the college at that point had just over 3,000 students on campus, again, because we were coming out of COVID. So there's still a lot of remote going on. So a couple things on here I just want to point out, but student spending was at $8.3 million annually. The students that do come, they come to work and they come to spend. And they do contribute to the local economy quite a bit. And then, of course, our operational spending. That number is just operational for Belleville that period. But we're probably going to be investing just shy of $10 million before we're out of year two out of here, just on investments and people and staff that are going to go into this institution to get us up and running. So it's a large investment that we've committed to come. To the regional economy, the college in Belleville generates just under $400 million in economic benefit. So, that's about 3,000. So let's just say it's a seventh the size of what we're looking at Port Hope, and you can do the math, and that would be roughly what to expect as an economic spinoff from the college coming into town. Okay. But the reason I'm here, housing. So you probably are aware that we have been doing regular town halls in Port Hope, actually since the new year, every 4 to 6 weeks we've been out. I've come to every one of them. We've had different themes for them, depending on what people we think want to hear. The one consistent thing that keep coming up was housing. And so we're listening. And so the first thing that drove the discussion about 230 Walton was we got a phone call that there was an opportunity for us to partner to actually create some housing for some students. And understanding and listening, we said, you know what? I think we have an obligation to try to invest a bit more money to get this up and running, and maybe try to take some of the strain off of the local community from a housing perspective. We don't think most of the domestic students will need housing. They tend to be regional here. They'll probably commute. We actually even suspect a good chunk of our international population will actually commute as well in the first year, because you are so close to the GTA, we'll find that some of them will commute. So we won't know exactly until they're all here. We just know that there is a tendency to commute. It also comes down to where they can find some jobs while they're in school. So if they know there's work here, they will live here. If they can't find work here, they will live where their work is, and then they will commute to school. But they will look here first for work. It's also one of the reasons why we wanted to get the housing up, is because we know if we can get people living here, they will work here, and then they will spend here, and they will contribute to the local economy, which is what we want to see happen. The other reason we liked 230, of course, was, and you did a great job of describing it all, but it's there's parking. To your point, students don't own cars anymore. Our parking lot, when the college was first built in Belleville, was a commuter college. Everybody drove. We had over 2,700 parking spots. Today, that we use 1,500 regularly. It's just serious. The people just don't drive anymore. Everybody's either carpooling, or they're taking local transit, or they're walking. And so the fact that this is close enough that they will walk, if you kind of look at what the numbers do, we've got 600 beds at the campus at Belleville. We maybe have 50 spots that students use out of 600 beds. So it's a very, very low ratio of the number of students that do have cars that would come in and do things. So this is actually us to try to come back and do what we can to start with the housing. It's something we can be proactive about. It's better with us dealing with it now than trying to fix it in September. So that's why we're trying to deal with it now. We will not, I will promise you this much, is that we will not have any students living on the roads when they come here in September. We will find a place for them, or I will pay to put them up somewhere else. They will not be sitting on the street corner looking for work or wandering the streets looking for a place to have a house. We've done it before, and it's just who we are. We will do it. So that's just the thing. Thank you for listening, and if you have any questions.
It's wonderful. Thanks, Mark. I really appreciate that. Council, any questions?
Just for what would be your campus size at Belleville in terms of students?
Oh, sorry. This year it'll be about 4,000 students.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions? No, saying none. Thanks so much, Bruce. We're going to move on to correspondence now. I'm going to turn it over to our deputy clerk once again to speak to the correspondence that we have received.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The Planning Department received two comments from the public, which were included as part of the agenda that was posted last week. I can confirm that the municipality is in receipt of a further five pieces of correspondence post-printing of the agenda from interested parties. The comments are in relation to questions regarding the operation of the facility and questions regarding parking, traffic, first responder access, resident safety, and zoning concerns. I can further confirm that this application submission was also circulated to all applicable internal and external agencies, and all comments will be summarized and presented in a future report. In addition, the notice of complete application and public meeting for the zoning bylaw amendment application was mailed to all assessed persons within 120 meters of the subject lands on May 26, 2023. The notice was also published on the current applications page of the municipal website, and a sign was erected on the subject lands explaining the application. Thank you.
Great. Thanks very much. And before we move to submissions from members of the public, are there any final questions from council? You've been awfully quiet. No? Everyone's good? Great. Okay. So let's move towards submissions from members of the public. Before we begin submissions from the public, I would like to note that the agenda contains important information with respect to question period and your opportunity to provide your comments on this matter in the appeal process. I will remind you that if you want to have the ability to appeal the eventual decision of the Municipality of Port Hope to the Ontario Land Tribunal, you must make either a written submission or make comments at a public meeting before the proposed bylaw is considered for adoption. All interested parties who wish to speak to this matter tonight should approach the microphone. Please state your name and address for the record. I also want to remind those of you in attendance, but especially those looking to speak this evening, please ensure that you complete the sign-in sheet that's near the entrance before you leave. The sheet assists municipal staff as it provides a record of attendance and contact information if a notice of decision is requested. Good? Okay. And for anyone who didn't make it tonight, if you're watching us from home, if you want to write in, if that you have that option as well. So there you go. Hi, everyone at home. Anyone would like to come forward? We'll take submissions.
Hello, everybody. Button. I'm Lee Caswell. I live on this Baldwin Street in behind. My first house actually was directly behind the subject property when it was the Children's Aid way back in the early 80s. So I have I'll just read what I've got, and then maybe I had a couple of comments from things we've heard tonight too. Okay, I'd like to speak to the concept of the old police station being transformed into a college dormitory to house 20 students. As a 42-year home owner in the neighborhood, that's a tongue twister, having owned three houses on Church and Baldwin Street, along with a career in real estate where I have sold 14 houses, some of them multiple times on this same two streets, Church or and or Baldwin, I have a number of concerns with the proposed bylaw amendment. The proposed zoning bylaw amendment states that there is on-site parking for 20 vehicles. In my professional opinion, which I believe this statement to be false, and approximately 10 cars could park there. I mean, even that diagram, that was pretty spooky. I could see a few fender benders before they've happened. And where would any guest parking be? There's no mention of that. Where would a dumpster and recycling bins be? I assume they'd be out back there somewhere. I'd like to shed some light on an already major parking issue at Church and Baldwin Street we face currently. Baldwin Street has the unusual feature of having the road is a dead end at one end and forms an S curve at the other end, changing its name to Charles. But if you carry on straight either direction, you're going into somebody's private driveway. So already, both these homes, which I have sold in the past at each end, are $2 million plus homes. This situation creates limited space for street parking. Currently, the house at the corner is not able to park at their own home and are forced to park on the street, one of which appears to drive... Currently, the house number 224 cannot even get into their backyard, which is... they used to kind of swing out onto the police station parking lot to get in. They cannot do that anymore. When the last homeowner was selling, he aligned his Winnebago up there, and nobody could get into the 224 parking where there are two units. One of these people, I believe, drives a commercial truck with a trailer, and some friends here in the building have the privilege of having him and his trailer park out in front of their house all the time. So already I see a problem there. So it makes next to impossible for any current homeowner and these cars to be able to navigate parking. Then in the winter, we have an additional problem with the Skitch apartments, which are across the road. We're pictured in the one drawing up there. It's not called that anymore, but in the olden days, that's what it was called. And the Skitch apartments cannot negotiate their driveway down in the winter because it's very steep, the ravine heading down toward, I'll call it the Lions Center direction. It's a bit of a nightmare, and all those cars tend to park on, and they're not allowed to park on Walton / Rideout during the winter, so they all park on Church. Anyway, it's a nightmare for snow removal. They're parked there, the plows go around, and we have this huge piles of snow that are, there's nowhere for it to go. It's a big nightmare. Okay. Then seasonally, we encounter the parking issues. Just this past weekend, on June 10th, we were faced with parking issues for one day, I stress one day, around 900 people, probably 300 to 400 cars with multiple people inside were enjoying a garden tour on the corner of Church and Baldwin. That was one of the houses. Residents on the two streets know that on these days, the driveways will become impossible to navigate, but we just bear with it. It's one day, so nobody's really too upset. And what is going on there? We have events there that are benefiting the whole town, fundraising by the local branch of the ACO for garden tours and house tours and so on. They are able to raise a lot of funds to restore buildings downtown Port Hope and so on. The current parking situation needs to be addressed now, and things need to change. And no additional parking should be added to an already nightmarish street, ones that the current neighborhood already endures. I wish to be part of finding a solution with the current problem and suggest a committee consisting of neighbors and town staff to try to find a solution for this problem. It really is a nightmare. As I say, I've lived there on and off for 40 some years. And what it really came to a head was when the Walton Street construction was going on and a lot of traffic tried to, and you get down to the dead end of Baldwin and you have to find some magical way to turn around. UPS trucks, it really is a problem. I'm not making it up. Just come and observe it. It's really something. And garbage trucks and so on. One of our biggest economic boosts to this town is the entertainment industry. The majority of residents in Port Hope are very house proud and contribute to a setting with bricks and mortar and the filming of desirable projects like It. Two movies have been shot. Presently, the TV series is ongoing or presently shooting. Murdoch Mysteries are a couple that have been filmed in Port Hope. Why do these projects choose Port Hope? Because we have something which is not found everywhere. We need to keep up and with the current environment to attract future projects to our town. Port Hope already has an example of a school and residents associated with it, already existing with Central School on Pine Street, the other direction, Pine Street North, and the old B&B, I'm having a mind blank as to what it was called, on Walton Street. The old tea room. Anyway, that these two properties do not currently lend to an appealing environment. The properties are currently ill-kept, particularly the B&B. Yeah, I didn't check today, but the other day the grass was up to my knee, and curtains facing the street were kind of disheveled, and a whole bunch of boxes sort of thrown into the window from the inside. It just looked kind of abandoned. So how do these two properties in their current state appeal to an upcoming project and add beauty to our historic town? As the property in question for this rezoning bylaw amendment is located on the main street, what is the town going to do to ensure what is currently happening with the state of this school and the B&B does not happen to the old police station? I'm aware that the only time the municipality reacts to anything substandard is by a written complaint from the public. I've outlined the parking concerns pertaining to the current zoning bylaw amendment change request, but I also have additional concerns. The current amendment states that the contract could be renewed for an additional 3 years. This should not be an automatic renewal. The same process should be put in place so the neighbors of Church Baldwin are provided an opportunity to voice their concerns, objections to what they have encountered. Will there be some questions just in general? Will there be someone in charge on the site at all times? Will garbage recycling and storage, where will that be handled? Will the town inspect and make sure the safety standards are maintained? Will there be cooking permitted on site, common bathrooms or individual baths? Has there been a study complete with water waste capacities for this new development, given the current infrastructure, just as in any other development? How much thought has been given to having 18-year-old residents residing amongst a quiet residential community? This will, I know you've stated they could be 20-year-olds or 47-year-olds or whatever, but for some of them, this will be their first time on their own away from home. Add that on top of the novelty of living in an old jail. That was part of the advertising campaign for it. They had an article, I don't know if it was in the Post or the Toronto Star. Yeah, we live in an old jail. It was really cool. And, you know, I tend to think there'd be a lot of kids drag everybody there to show them their cell. I personally feel this allowance will not be an attempt to rubber stamp the future for this location. This should not be the case. These historic neighborhoods need a light hand in dealing with them. This is not a cookie cutter neighborhood or a modern subdivision, and great skill and planning is required. These are a few questions which must be addressed, and point out that there are many unanswered questions and holes in this process regarding this zoning change. I believe this bylaw needs to be tabled until further investigations can be completed and a solution to the current parking issues are dealt with. A couple of other things that have just come up since seeing what we've seen here. There was no mention of how long the lease is on the school. So, I mean, is the school planning to be here for a goodly long time? Why are there no residences being planned for Pine Street? It seems they signed up for a school. I mean, I'm not trying to condemn anybody here, but I just think I'm not getting the connection, the process of thought here. If you're building a school, of course, we've admitted that the residence problem is a number one. It almost should have been the first problem addressed before the school, to my way of thinking, but and medical. Already, it's really, really tough to get any kind of medical coverage for any of us. Emergency waits for 5 hours at the local hospital. So I'm not sure what condition might be put in for looking after medical issues of proposed students. And you, Mr. Kirkpatrick mentioned local transit. That's, well, I don't know much about it, the bus, but I know the taxi situation. I've spoken to a friend, and it's pretty pitiful to try to get a taxi on any given occasion. You have to sort of plead and beg. So that's about all I have to say, and I thank you for the opportunity.
Wonderful. Thanks, Lee. Appreciate that. Would anyone else like to make a submission from Kemp? Please. It looks like the microphone might still be on. Oh, yeah, Tree. Yeah, go ahead.
Tree,
yeah.
Young, 20 Baldwin Street. And I'm not going to read my letter, only because you have a copy of it, okay? But there are four things that do concern me. And there are, I've written down four key points. But definitely, I'm hoping that council will direct staff to definitely look at the parking issue on Baldwin and Church Street. The number of driveways that pull off Church Street, multiple cars coming onto a very short street out of their parking spots, plus the parking that's been identified with the commercial vehicles parking on Church Street, and the winter parking from Walton and Rideout. The other thing that we've faced is when I started living on Baldwin, you had one bag of garbage, every household, one bag per week. Now we have four containers and two different garbage trucks coming down, recycling and garbage, coming down Baldwin to a dead end. They go forward, they back up, beep, 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 all the way down and come out again. But that happens on Church and on Baldwin. So the congestion on the street, along with parking issue on certain days, plus snow removal and lawn equipment. I park on the street when, for example, I had the mason working on brickwork on my home for 2 weeks. He parked in the driveway while he did his work so he could get his tools and everything out. I parked on the street. But other people were parking on the street as well. Lawn mowing equipment with trailers and everything else. So that's a main concern. And the safety of pulling out of your driveway in the winter is, this past winter was ridiculous. The other thing, and the number of homes on Baldwin that have gone from single family dwellings, one at the very end has gone to it's a duplex, but one half of the duplex has been turned into two units. So there are now going to be two families there. Another house on the street, diagonal from myself, unfortunately, my neighbor passed away. The house is being rented out. The last renter had, during COVID, come out of Toronto, one car. The new renters now have two. So they now have one parking spot on their property. The other spot is on the road. So the changes have to be assessed in terms of the community. The other is, for me, privacy. As a community, we have put up with the single family dwelling owner of the former police station with the Winnebago, Sea-Doos, Ski-Doos, motorcycles. I can name the number of vehicles that he has rented out to that we look at coming in and off Baldwin Street. So I was suggesting in my letter, and I hope Loyalist College will consider, and that is a privacy area in the parking lot, fenced off for the students. If the students can walk the 5 minutes up the road to the dormitory and 5 minutes down the road, could the parking lot not become a private place for the students to smoke, get together, recreation, et cetera. And that was also included in my letter. And if it's fenced off, it's out of view. And the last point I'd like to make is the rezoning issue, because while I was on the garden tour, I heard from someone, well, you know, you're lucky it's not being zoned for a five-story apartment building. So my concern is to the future, and if people are already talking about that, it may well happen. So, and I understand from what was said tonight that any future rezoning would be addressed by public notice. So I'm pleased to hear that. And there is the Comfort in Hampton Inn up the road.
Great. Thanks, Trudy. Yes, anyone else? Yeah, I know we have one, at least one more. Great. As you come up, just name an address, please.
Hello. Hi. Brian Buttery, 240 Rideout Street. So I'm just three doors up the street from the proposed development. And I just wanted to say that I welcome Loyalist College to town. I support having a college in town. I think it's a great opportunity for Port Hope. My issue is not with Loyalist, but, and I know these students need some place to live, but like everyone else, the parking is not going to work. There are not 18 parking spots there. You would need a valet to get 18 cars in and out of there. And you'd need State Farm on residents there for the number of accidents. It's not, I mean, Church Street itself is, what, like 200 feet long? The number of vehicles already entering and exiting from Church Street, you're going to have to put a light at Church Street and Walton. There'll be so much traffic from there. I don't think that we can plan for only the best case scenario that probably most of these students won't have cars. That's not acceptable. So that was my statement about the parking. There is, as Trudy mentioned, there is no outdoor space there. And students tend to want to get outside once in a while. The parking lot is really their only place to do that. And they're going to congregate there. I don't know if there are 18 cars in the parking lot where they're going to do that. And the other issue, like Lee mentioned, was there's definitely going to be guests there. Where are the guests going to park? Where are their parents going to park? You know, that all that sort of thing. The issue also of the 3 years, I have a major problem with that. It's, you're calling it suites, but it's basically a rooming house, and say Loyalist decides that's not a place they want to be after 3 years. So a new developer takes it over, and it's a rooming house with 20 people in it now who are not students. I realize there'll be a meeting about that, but I still have a serious issue with that. I don't think it should be turned into a place that houses 20 people. I think that's way too ambitious. I understand, like I said, that students need a place to live, but I can't see that supporting more than about 10 students. And, you know, in the future, possibly 10 renters or whatever they might be. Along with Lee, I wanted to emphasize that this is a heritage neighborhood. It's not a designated one, but it definitely is. And there's a lot of value in that. And we can't have, we can't have uses really that don't fit the current usage. I wanted to ask also, and I don't know if it's been addressed, but if the college is in town for all three semesters, it would be, I'm sure that the neighborhood would support it if they got the summer off, say, if there was just the fall and spring semester. So I don't know the answer to that, but and I think, yeah, the last point I had was the same one that Trudy just raised. I don't understand why five-story buildings are allowed in residential neighborhoods in Port Hope. It came up last week during the hospital debate, and it just seems ridiculous to me, and it seems like Port Hope could save itself a lot of trouble by getting rid of that. You know, possibly three stories in a residential neighborhood, but five stories, you know, especially in the kind of neighborhoods that we have in the downtown here, it just seems completely untenable and out of character. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Is there anyone else who would like to make a submission before we, yes, please come on up.
Hi, my name is Diane Stebli. I live at 345 Lakeshore, which is just up the road. I have some concerns about the parking, and I lived at Baldwin Street, so I can speak from experience that there is a parking problem there. I have great concerns with that this is a three-year plan. That's not planning. 3 years is building and execution. I would challenge that it took more than 3 years to plan or 3 years to plan these nice things you're doing at Loyalist College. And I'm in support of having education. I also have issues with some of these students. Being the mother of a student who is currently an international student in England, it doesn't seem to me that there's any thought about what these students are going to do. There's no place for them to go. I mean, it doesn't seem there's a thought process into this being a residential area. It seems like a stopgap to throw kids or young adults. And I'm uncomfortable with that, living right up the street, because it's now what? And to what Brian just said, you know, is it going to become a rooming house? What's the future here? I think if there was a 5-year plan, a 10-year plan, that would be more acceptable or more palatable. But it almost seems like a stopgap that, oh, well, you're going to change the zoning now. And in 3 years, well, we've already done this for 3 years. So now we're going to do this. And I grew up in construction and I know all about gravel pits. And I could tell you how you zone gravel pits. And they're called wayside pits. And then you do this and then you do this. It's all staged. And I feel that that's what's happening here. And we're being a little snowballed. To quote a program that we all know, there's something called looks good on paper. I think this looks good on paper, but in reality and execution, I'm not so sure as a resident of this town. Thank you.
Thanks, Diane. Any final submissions? Yes.
Hi, I'm Janet Eby, and I live at 239 Rideout Street. I'm not going to address the problem about parking. Other people have already done that, but I wanted to talk as a homeowner of a 165-year-old house. My husband and I moved here 17 years ago. We poured a lot of ourselves into that house to try to restore it and make it into a good home. And I have concerns about this. I have concerns about this because I don't believe that it's a good use in a residential neighborhood to have a 20-room dorm. And it's just out of character for the neighborhood. So I worry about that. I also worry about the temporary status of this. And I'd like to reflect on the comments that Brian has made and Diane has made. It just, I'm worried as well that what this is it's temporary now. It's going to become permanent. And to Councillor Andrew's question earlier, that this is eventually going to morph into a 5-story building, which will destroy the entrance to the downtown area. We've all put a lot of time, energy, and money into our houses. That is the entrance a lot of people use to get into the downtown, and it's beautiful. We've made it beautiful. We've kept it beautiful. And if you put in a 5-story building there, we may as well just fold up our tents and leave. So I wanted to say that. I also wanted to know whether or not there is a guarantee that this will only be Loyalist students. And if they don't fill this with Loyalist students, will this become a rooming house now or in the future? Thank you very much.
Thanks, Janet. Anyone else before we, yeah, Sue?
Good evening. I live at 231 Walton Street, directly across the road from the, it started as the Children's Aid Society, then it became the police station, then it became a private residence. During the time it was a police station, we did have very good consideration from the police. They did not park out in front of our place very often, and they didn't use the Walton Street entrance that much. They used the back parking lot. I am very eager to see the building once again used for a good purpose. And quite honestly, I see the Loyalist College residential units as a good purpose. I do have concerns about the conditions. I would love for people who live there to have some access to grass, or not necessarily grass, because I'm not really in favor of grass. Look at my front yard. But I would like them to have exterior access and not in the two little lots sitting on Walton Street. That's not exactly recreational space. The crowding seems to me to be quite extensive. There's not only the 20 residents, but there's also the on-site supervisor who I imagine would have perhaps a partner and maybe a family. Yes, it sounds as if parking is reduced, but Miss, is it Kirkpatrick? Mr. Kirkpatrick mentioned that a lot of the students will be commuters already commuting to the college. And I would imagine that if you're living in a dormitory in Port Hope, you would need to work elsewhere to help you pay your fees. And Mr. Kirkpatrick also mentioned that they would be looking for work in Port Hope. In that case, you need a vehicle. And I'm sorry, Claire, I see your face, but there won't be as many as you using e-bikes. And the parking has me concerned. Also, why I mention food is because I've been visualizing in my mind all the deliveries of pizzas and all sorts of other things. I simply have concerns about the use of the building for that many people with the parking lot the way it is. I do welcome both international and domestic students. And I think if the municipality wants to increase density in all the urban area of Port Hope, that working out parking problems, garbage truck and recycling access, all of those things should be done for a lot of our neighborhoods because they're not really accessible. And when I first moved to Port Hope, before I lived in my current house for 47 years, I lived next door in what was called the Sketch Apartments. And we did have trouble getting down there with vehicles in the winter. But there are situations that can be worked out. And we can encourage more walking. Walking between, I had a question about the St. Mary's facility, the main campus. Will there be a cafeteria? Does anyone know?
Yeah, apparently there will be.
Well, perhaps all the people from the dormitory will go down to the cafeteria. That way, it's going to be very slippery going down Walton Street. I've done that too. This is not a blanket approval, but I'm pleased to see the building being used for something that's valid and good for the community. Thank you.
Thanks, Sue. Appreciate that. Any final submissions for this evening? Yep, got another one. Just remember to your name and address, please.
Hello, my name is Bev Batchelor, and I live at 9 Church Street, which is right across the road from 8 Church Street, which is actually the parking space. One of the things that has not been brought up tonight, I don't think, is the noise issue. The reason I came to Port Hope was I fell in love with a house. And I mean, I've been here 12 years now, and that house means the world to me. I do not have a problem with accepting students into the community. I think that is fine. But I don't think living in a residential area is the place to have a residence. My concern also is the fact, yes, there will be supervision on site. Is that an adult? Is that a student who's put in charge of the site? I would like to know how that is pertained. And what happens when we do run into noise? If that happens, do we call the police? Are we putting more effort and using their manpower for really inconsequential reasons? I don't know. I just, I do not think it's proper to have that as a use unless you have a fencing put up, sound barriers in place, so that the residents in the neighborhood that are paying taxes and supporting the community have some answers for all of this. Anyways, that's just my concern.
That's great. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone. Are there any other final comments before we wrap up? Yeah, Brian, you have another one?
I know the next door neighbor who couldn't be here tonight it's Walton still, did have that concern about sound, and he expects that there will be a soundproof barrier put up between his house and the approximately maybe 10 feet between the building and his driveway. But my other issue was, and I just wanted it noted for the record, that there seems to be work going on in the building without any evident permit. I don't see one posted, but you can see a retaining wall through the window. There's been stuff torn out of there. So I just wanted that noted, that there already seems to be work in progress. Thank you.
Great. Good to know. Thanks, Brian. Trudy? Yeah.
One last comment based on something I believe Sue said about pizza deliveries. Will there be laundry deliveries? Will there be cleaning product deliveries? Will there be cleaning staff coming
to clean the building on a regular basis, and the property outside. And I understand Loyola said they were looking after that. But that begs the question of where do they go for deliveries?
Great. Thanks. Todd, did you want to speak before we move forward? Is that what we're... No. Okay. No. Okay. That's great. Well, thank you so much, everyone. That concludes our submissions from the public. I really want to thank everyone for bringing forward, lots of good things come forward. It's good for us to hear these things. Mark, I'm sure you feel the same way. It's good to hear the comments and such. So. Okay. Yeah. So that's great. Yeah. Because I know there were, as we go through this, as people are speaking, there are questions that are sort of floating around where you say, and I wonder about this, I wonder about that. So thanks, Mark, for offering to do that. Before we continue, are there any final questions from council? I know I've given you like five opportunities, but if anything else came up, any questions on this? Nope, seeing none. Great, then I'm going to ask for a mover and a seconder to recommend action being that committee receive this report for information and direct staff to prepare a report to the committee of the whole once all outstanding matters, including items brought forward at the public meeting held on June 15th, 2023, regarding proposed zoning bylaw amendment application ZB07-2023 on 230 Walton Street be addressed. Can I get a mover and a seconder? Moved by Mayor Elena, seconded by Councillor Less, and all in favor? And carried. Thanks very much. And this concludes the public meeting for tonight. The meeting is adjourned. One last reminder, I think, for everyone, if you haven't signed the sheet, please make sure you sign, especially if you did that. And thanks very much for coming out tonight.